I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Programming is supported by UCare, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCare. Healthcare that starts with you.
I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting today from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. I'm pleased to have as my guest today a gentleman that I have always regarded and continue to hold up as a freedom fighter, as a leader par excellence, a gentleman who has dedicated life and limb to the struggle for freedom for black people, I say for humanity. Spike Moss. Spike, good morning, man. Good to see you.
Good morning to you, Al. It's an honor to be here.
Well, I wanted to have this conversation with you, and we're going to introduce Brother Thomas Barker in a minute or two, just to put in context the things going on right now in North Minneapolis. Today, it was announced at about 4 in the morning, the encampment at the 4th Precinct, the encampment created in protest by Black Lives Matter, the protest challenging the city's response to the police shooting of Jamar Clark. That protest has lasted maybe 20 days or 15 days as a barricaded encampment at the occupation at the 4th Precinct. That was removed and dismantled this morning. And so I wanted to get a review of what has happened from the observing eye of a community elder. Your view is particularly important because the 4th Precinct sits on the site of the way. That space was and is at some level still a sacred space.
Our hollow ground.
Hollow ground for our community. So sort of give us a reflection on what has happened today and where this protest will go as you see it.
Well, what has happened today is it's the middle ground of a lifelong struggle for me to witness. I fought police brutality cases for 54 years. I first saw what was wrong at 15. I was clear at 16. 17, I could actually respond to it. But the one thing I learned in Minneapolis, there was nothing we could do about it except take the abuse and take the murders. There was no one to go to, there was no office, and there was no one who would stop it. And so those murders went on all those years that I could remember. Those beatings went on all those years that I could remember. And Minnesota was in charge of the media, and they made sure that the rest of the world never knew we were Ferguson before Ferguson, because they didn't allow anything to leave here about the condition of our people. So when this last shooting happened, the organization Black Lives Matter across America was bringing it to the public, right into the eye. And by technology like phones and videotapes, you now can show what they used to lie about. We didn't have that equipment. We'd say what happened, we had no credibility, and they would move on, and we would swallow another murder. This equipment allows us to show that I was always right. We were vilified for telling the truth. It shows that it's been going on and going on across America. And the only way you can bring attention to it is to protest. You have to publicly sacrifice yourselves in a country that won't respect you as a citizen or respect your rights in terms of freedom, justice, and equality. You have to make it happen, they won't do right. Mr. Stanek, who is our sheriff, said 2 years ago, there is no accountability and no punishment for Minneapolis Police Department, so there'll never be an order because there's no accountability and there's no consequences for their actions.
What was the basis for him saying that? Why would he, and you don't normally hear that kind of,
that?
Yeah, sheriff said about a police department, two different jurisdictions but the same community.
He felt they were out of control.
Okay.
And because they're out of control, what you see happening would happen. So as a sheriff, he said out of his mouth, no consequences, no accountability. This is going to happen until you have that. He also used to say they need to go into receivership. No different than when I served on the mandated federal government Justice Department mediation. They were supposed to go in receivership if they broke the contract. Well, the mayor didn't participate. The chief of police didn't participate. That means you broke the contract. The Minneapolis Police Department at that point supposed to go into receivership.
But it didn't.
And it didn't. Mm-hmm. And that's the first thing we have to put back on the table, receivership. Mm-hmm. Also, the Justice Department, when they come in here, like they did
what,
Ferguson.
What does receivership mean, just so people
Well, know. You take a branch like the U.S. Attorney or the U.S. Marshal or the Sheriff's Department or the FBI or a private entity, they take total control of everyday things that go on in the police department. They have no more authority. Mm-hmm. You run it, you clean it up, you fix it.
But that happened in Ferguson, right? Or
that happened in New Orleans. The first time I saw it happen was in New Orleans.
Okay.
But what happened in Ferguson was the Justice Department went in and proved the problem. We need them to do that here. The same department under Obama that went in there has to come here, and they will find the same results, but only worse, only worse. And it's been longer. As a matter of fact, at this present time, we got 962 cases, one officer suspended for 1 week.
In Minneapolis.
So that means that 900, and that's been your record since last year to right now, that you have 961 cases never dealt with.
Police brutality. Okay.
And so you lose millions of dollars every year because you lose the case because they're insulated and protected, but they can't protect themselves from that bodily harm that they did to that victim. So they're constantly taking tax money and paying off these lawsuits. Mm-hmm. They just announced yesterday in Chicago, Illinois, that they have paid out today over $500 million in lawsuits for police brutality. Mm-hmm. They announced that they had shot more than 300 citizens, the police have. They announced that they had over 3,000 cases and only one was dealt with. So as long as they're insulated, it keeps going on. And so you go out there, you get the attention, you got it, but now you have to move to the next level. The next level, believe it or not, is the state capitol because their protection comes from state laws. You see, there's a law that protects them. As a matter of fact, if I'm an officer and I strike you, which is an assault, I won't get it charged with an assault. But until you investigate the crime, I'll get a week off with pay from your tax dollar. Mm-hmm. Then if you do take me to court, I'll get a free pay lawyer from your tax dollar. Mm-hmm. And if you do win the case, your tax dollar pays the lawsuit. Mm-hmm. I don't have to do anything but keep beating and abusing people. So you have to change the legislation that allows that. Also, every officer has to have insurance and bonding. If you get so many cases with insurance and bonding, you lose it. Make the officer buy his own. If he buys his own and he loses it, he loses his license to practice law on the street. So you put him in that kind of situation. Also, you make sure that a city pays 60% of the lawsuit and the officer pays 40. He can't keep his house, two-car garage, motorcycle, boat, send his kids to college when he's losing his job, his income.
Because
you put him,
actions.
Yes, because of his actions, he's putting himself in that situation, make him pay for that. He wouldn't be so readily ready to do what he's doing if there was consequences. That's the sheriff's point. There's no consequences. And so when there's consequences for your actions and you pay up for your actions, a whole lot of them would stop doing what they're doing. But even deeper than that, when I assault you, I'm charged and I go to jail. He does not. He needs to go to jail for the crime he commits. If I commit murder, I go to jail for murder. He needs to go to jail for murder. Right now, while we sit here in the United States of America, police department is responsible for 1,150 some murders. That has nothing to do with how many people they shot. That's just the murders. And so this epidemic, that was this year. What they released this year about 2 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
So to change this mentality in this epidemic, these things have to be put in place. So you can't stay out in front of the precinct forever. You have to move to the Capitol and challenge this legislation that allows them to get away with this. And you can't have two Americas. You can't have one where all of us in this room go to jail for the law we break, and law enforcement never goes to jail for the law they break.
Over the years, you said you've been conscious and active since you've been 15, 16 years old. And I know that year in and year out, say in the past 20 years, 15, 30 years that I've known you, you've been on the front line challenging injustice and racism. As often as not, Spike, people in our community will say, why doesn't Spike Moss be quiet? Mm-hmm. Why didn't he stop? They want to call you a grandstander, a publicity seeker, mm-hmm. and trivialize or diminish the value of the work that you do. Mm-hmm. While that work is protecting them, mm-hmm. how does that make you feel? Is that a fair description of what has happened from time to time or not?
Yes, but when a people come from 250 years of slavery and the indoctrination that came from that indoctrination,
that's what you get.
We still carry that mentality of being owned and being slaves and being less than, and we were taught to love, honor, respect, and fear thy master, hate thyself and those who look like thee. Mm-hmm. So I expect that, so it doesn't bother me that you have slave mentality within our people. Mm-hmm. That, however, will not change my mind about the right for freedom, justice, and equality. The one thing that I have as an advantage is I've never forgot where I came from. I never forgot that it was a table like this that I was taught to understand, and I witnessed as an older child that I was born on my grandfather's house because we couldn't cross that train track and go to the clinic for all whites only. So me and my sister were born here, my mother and all her siblings were born here in this house on this table. Those are my driving forces. My sister and I are the last two of my family to be raised in Jim Crow. I understand what it is not to be allowed to go to a public school, a public college, go to a public park, swim in a public swimming pool, go to the movie show, being denied all of that, being denied going inside a restaurant and sit down and eat, going uptown and looking into the department store windows, but not allowed to go inside and try on anything. That's my history. And to come to the North and all of a sudden act like that didn't happen, and I don't care, it's too much for me. I was 9 years old when I was uptown on a hot day, and I wanted just a drink of water.
In South Minneapolis.
I was in Missouri.
Oh, Missouri. Okay.
And my mother, I said, Mom, I want a drink of water. She said, you can't have that water, son. I said, Mom, I want a drink of water. You can't have that water, son. That's for whites only. I was holding her hand, and I looked up at 9 years old, and I had enough sense to say, Mama, one day I'm going to drink that water. Mm-hmm. It was in me then to understand we were treated differently. And I've never forgot that day downtown with my mother. But I've never forgot any of the history that I was put through or my ancestors was put through to understand our right to be treated fairly, freedom, justice, equality. I would have volunteered to be a freedom fighter over and over again if God gave me 10 more lives, because people shouldn't be subjected to this type of life in the land of the free. I've been called political. If I was in Russia talking about our right to be free when they were a communist country, then I should be political. But why am I called political in a country where it's supposed to be freedom and I want freedom, unless it's political for a black man to think he should be free? Then I was called controversial. If I talked about freedom in Russia, I should have been controversial. But how am I controversial in America, a free country, talking about freedom, unless it's controversial for a black man to think he should be free? So we have to be clear first. I'm clear. That I have a right, that I am a human being, that I am a man. I have a right to fair treatment, human justice, and equality. And as long as it's in my soul and in my mind and my heart, another person that doesn't know what I know will never, ever bother me from what they say out of their mouth, because their heart and their mind and their soul has to be free like mine to get to my level. I just try to help them get there. I don't feel bad about them. I feel sorry for them. And I try to help them get there. Free your mind.
There has to be a sense of, not satisfaction, but a sense of awareness that everything you talked about is now being revealed.
Yes.
We talked about the technology where people can document neighborhood by neighborhood, incident by incident,
yes.
encounter by encounter, and the evidence is overwhelming. Mm. The complaints we have made, the charges we have made nationwide and here included, have been valid, and we have been denied mm-hmm. the ability to know mm-hmm. that what they may describe as an isolated incident mm-hmm. is in fact a practice and a policy. And the policy is a policy of oppression, and the practice is a practice of discrimination, marginalization of our people. It gives you some satisfaction, I'm sure, in saying that the technology now is validating what the society and the power structure wanted to deny.
Well, from the perspective that when we stepped out to talk about the way we were treated, we were vilified. We were called black militants, troublemakers, activists, everything but freedom fighters fighting for our right to be free. For God, I put it on God, to allow me to live long enough to all the things I fought for are now being exposed all over this country is great gratification for me. I'm very proud that God has allowed me to see the things that I risked my life for, the things that I went to jail for, to see publicly the reality of truth is stronger than all that wrong, and the truth has now come to the light. And folks have to look at me in a different way now and say, he always knew. He always told us the truth. I mean, I remember Spike Moss doesn't know what he's talking about. That's a lie. Police don't do that. And to have the satisfaction of being able to witness it in front of the world, or my children or grandchildren witness it in front of the world, is a great gratification.
One of the issues, and I talk again about how we, as the victims of historical trauma, mm-hmm. of slavery, we will often be super critical of each other. Mm-hmm. We trust white people, we don't trust black people. Trust the master, don't trust yourself, right? Mm-hmm. And I have seen you respond to the criticism that we often will criticize white folks for the aggression against our people, but we don't respond to black-on-black crime. Mm-hmm. That simply is not the case, but make that argument, because too often you hear our own people saying, I wish they would shut up. Where are they when this 9-year-old in mm-hmm. Chicago got killed? Where are they when people get shot here in Minneapolis, St. Paul? And the truth is, our voices are there at the same time. But talk about that.
Well, you know, I was deep into civil rights and human rights work when I noticed the change in the 1980s that black males had begun to shoot one another and kill one another. And I put together At-Risk Youth Service, and from that I built United for Peace, and for that I built with several people the National Peace and Justice Gang Summits to bring peace, to get them to put down the guns and stop killing. I stayed on that level from the 80s all the way to this day, still begging and pleading with young men to stop fighting and killing one another. It is one thing to criticize a white man when he shoots one black, and the same week you shot 20 blacks. And even when you look at Chicago, they're fighting right now over one young man who was shot 16 times. I'll be the first to admit it was wrong. But as of three Wednesdays back, when I took down the last statistics of Chicago, they had already, on that Wednesday, shot and killed 444 black people. They had shot 2,000 black people.
Had shot blacks.
Black people. Mm-hmm. They had shot a total of 2,639 black people. And so it's ridiculous to say,
are
black people shooting black people? Mm-hmm. It's ridiculous to say black lives matter, but only when a white person shoots you. Either you matter or you don't. Murder is murder. It doesn't matter if I shoot you or shoot a white man, it's murder. And for our people to not see that, it sickens me, that your children could engage in something as tremendous as murder on one another at a rate that has never been witnessed in this nation. We have killed more black people than have died in the Vietnam War. We have killed more black people than the Klan themselves have killed. We have killed more black people than we lost trying to get free from slavery. As a matter of fact, if you go back to the 1980s to 2015 and anybody digs up that number, we're going to be well in the 200,000 to 300,000 people who've lost their life at the hand of their own people. Now, do I understand it? Yes. They taught us to hate ourselves. We do. I came up as a proud African American. These children call themselves the N-word. The Klan don't do it. They do it. They call our women B's and S's. We didn't do that. We loved ourselves. So all of this makes sense. They're removed from their reality of who they are, their own black history. They're only taught white history. They're removed from their culture. They don't know their culture or their heritage. They don't know where they came from. They don't know that they have a value. They don't know that they're human beings. They haven't been treated like human beings. This had to come to a boiling point, and it did in the 1980s, and it has been escalating ever since across this nation. There is no major city where black America is not killing black America more than any police officers will ever kill us. So we gotta watch our front and our back at the same time, which is ridiculous, until we get our young people to understand the importance of put down the gun. Put down the gun. And when you keep picking up that gun and killing yourself, you have become so disrespectful that you're killing 3-year-old, 5-year-old, 9-year-old, and 11-year-old children. You become so disrespectful that you're killing our girls and our women. You become so disrespectful that you'll go to any gathering that we might have and kill our people. So to me, I would say to young people, you need to focus on both, but focus on yourself first. Never look in someone else's backyard before you look in yours. Make sure your house is in order. So when we speak about racism and injustice, you speak about the injustice and unfairness you are inflicting on yourself. See, anytime an oppressor sees this weakness, they take advantage. But for me as a man, I would rather see my children with a pencil in their hand before a 9mm. I'd rather see my children with a book bag than a bag of dope. I'd rather see my children in a classroom than a cell room. I'd rather see my children live a successful life than the graveyard. And we have to say that.
Spike Moss, we'll come back in a minute and talk more. We'll bring in Brother Thomas Barker. Thomas Barker, coming out of a life of gang violence, directing community towards better futures and alternatives. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. Stay tuned. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. Today's broadcast from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. Pleased to continue this conversation. I promise a robust conversation, and this certainly is one. I want to bring into the conversation Brother Thomas Barker, Jr. Brother Barker, you have a history of being in organized gangs, and you've come out of that life, and you're organizing community programs now to provide alternatives and a way out for our young people. And I wanted to have you join me with Spike Moss here, sort of telling your story. The life is sometimes alluring. Sometimes our children feel that the pressure of peers, the pressure of what they see as potentially glamorous, the pressure of an excitement of drug dealing, drug using, all of that will steer us away from what we probably know is right, or some of us may not have been trained about what is right, you know, that ordinary people feel. If our life has been a life brought up in the life, that might be the only thing we know. So I wanted you to talk about what you have experienced and how you were involved in gangs. Talk about it in the context of what Spike just talked about. How many of our people are killing our people?
Well, first, let me give a little introduction of myself. I originally come from Ohio and raised up in an organized gang. Started coming out to Minnesota under the direction of Melita Kimmons. You know, she started doing One Family, One Community, and I reached out and I started building on website and all that as far as nonprofit goes. I was building a nonprofit while I was serving time in the prison. You know, I went to prison back in 1998. I have 5 kids, and once you start waking up to what's going on, you know what I'm saying, you start realizing you're going in the wrong direction, you know what I'm saying? So at that moment, I decided to change, and that's my story I tell the youth. You can change anytime you get ready to change. At that very moment you decide to, you can. So once I started realizing that, being in the game, I started really realizing, you know, it's not the gang that's getting me to do all this stuff. It's the luring, it's the wanting this and wanting that, you know, but I missed out on a whole lot of things, you know, and that's something we don't tell them. It's not you're missing out on direction on how to live. You know what I'm saying? So really, I going from a street life to a more complete life. In the street life, you so compound with things. You're not becoming yourself. You're losing your identity. You know what I'm saying? So it's not so much me trying to pull them out of the gang, but to change your lifestyle around. Mm-hmm. So I'm more about lifestyle change. You know what I'm saying? Lifestyle modification. It's because certain lifestyles leads to certain places. It leads to penitentiary.
So how are our children killing our children? How are we killing our, from your point of view, what's the story? Why is it that, why are we killing each other?
Most of it, I believe, is just mostly superficial. And it's, they don't realize the consequences. You know what I'm saying? We started, when the parents start giving the children consequences to things, you know what I'm saying? So they're not ready for the consequences in the world. You see what I'm saying? If you're not getting that consequence at home, you're not expecting it from the street.
How did you get started in getting into gang life yourself?
Well, I started hanging out in the street.
How old were you?
I was actually like 9.
Tell me the story.
I moved from Ohio out to Colorado. And being away from my father, my mother was a single parent. It's like 7 kids, you know, so she had to work. So all of us had to stay in around, lived in shelters, you know, had the hard life for a moment. You know what I'm saying? So we had time and access to the street. You know what I'm saying? So once she started getting things together, we moved into a house. We started going to school. I was introduced to the gang then. You know, I got jumped for wearing the wrong color. I didn't know nothing about it. You know what I'm saying? So I said, oh, well, I want to do that. You know what I'm saying? So I never was about fighting another gang because of that. You know what I'm saying? Because of that experience, I never, it was because you were something else. I didn't like you. I took you by your character after that. But, you know, so many do that, you know what I'm saying? Just because you're something else, it's different ideologies or different ways of viewing it. If you're a Christian, you're a Muslim, it's always something like that. It's never to see where we combine at, where we unite at, you know what I'm saying? We got the same problems, same issues out here, you know, economic issues, housing issues. We got too many issues to be trying to fight one another about superficial things. That's what I believe is mostly superficial and negative influences out here.
Superficial spike, but on the other hand, not because the consequences deadly. The consequences final. So yes, the motivation might be something that's totally irrational, insignificant, superficial, but the consequence, permanent, real, the devastation, the trauma. And this is an extension of historical trauma, I believe. We talked about slavery and how we act now as a consequence of coming out of that.
Right, but it's both. We've been traumatized without ever having a therapist, or a psychiatrist, or medication to help us. We were traumatized for more than 400 years. It's in our genes. However, we live in the most violent society in the history of the world, the United States of America. You live in the stomach of the beast. So you start out as a little boy. We started out as little boys. They taught us how to play cowboy and Indian. And we're supposed to kill the Indian. You're supposed to lay down and die.
Right.
So you're already being indoctrinated that it's all right to shoot somebody. Then you move into comic books, and they're so violent. And then you move into the TV series. They were so violent. Then we get to the movie show. It's even more violent. And so you're being indoctrinated with, right, this is how you take care of your differences. You kill somebody. And you start getting comfortable to the point that when you do a movie vicious like Don't Look in the Basement, Last House on the Left, Chainsaw Massacre, you don't walk out quiet. You walk out bragging about how good the movie was, showing you man's inhumanity to man. Now you're accepting it.
You're being cool.
Well, in the 1990s, here you come with these video games, teaching the kids to kill more. And you start to enjoy it, but you're also looking at these weapons. I want that gun. I want to be able to spray people. And so when you look around, we live in a society that says something stupid like this. Well, just because we gave you that movie don't mean you need to carry it out. Well, everybody's brainwave ain't the same level. Some people can figure out don't do it, but too many are dragged right in where they have no business going. But you get a steady dose of why to be violent and enjoying violent behavior and trying to participate in it. So when you give a kid a gun, he already watched enough TV to know what to do with it. And he already knows what's going to happen. You just don't know what he said, the consequences of after you fired a shot. But this country indoctrinates our children to be violent. When they talk about bullies, who made them bullies? You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So when you live in the most violent country in the world that only pushes violence, This is the outcome of that. Because if you go right north to Canada, them people still don't even lock their front doors. Mm-hmm. They don't lock their cars because crime is not accepted up there the way it's accepted down here. Remember, this country was founded on violence and founded on crime. We came here, stole the country, but we had to do murder to steal the land. We killed Native Americans, and we killed a people then called Mexican, today called Latino, and then we stole some people in a hostage way and made them slaves to work the stolen land. So the history of the country is violent and crime, and you are raised in the middle of the most hostile, violent nation in the history of the world, and you're acting out what you've learned. Our children are doing it. Our boys, our girls, our mothers, our fathers, and then the condition we live in, which is a powder keg of pressure. It pushes you over the edge. When you go over the edge, you already know what to do. Then you bring about the fact you would not have drugs in America if the white majority didn't want it. 88 to 89% of all drugs are here because of the white majority.
As consumers.
Yeah, so when you lace the people who are already angry, already hurt, already suffering with chemicals too, and then hand them a pistol, the outcome would look the exact way it looks. And then we act like, we put our hands behind us and act like, we don't know why those people are acting like that. You know what I'm saying? And all we're doing is pushing that. Then you gotta look at the Constitution. They don't wanna change the Constitution that gives everybody the right to bear arms. Look what has happened to America for bearing arms. They're still over in Europe when you do a crime, blowing a whistle and the police surround you and catch you. They're not shooting everybody. And the criminals are not shooting everybody. But here, all of that's acceptable behavior. And now we got what's called licensed gun buyers, who are no more than licensed gun runners, who can go any gun show and buy as many guns as they can afford and don't have to report to anyone, fill out any applications, do any paperwork, and then drop those guns off and sell wherever they want in this country to a people who might not be qualified to handle a gun. All of that is in this mix.
You once talked about trying to pursue legislation that required liability of the gun manufacturer.
That's right.
When a gun or weapon was used in a capital crime or a murder.
That's right.
What's the discussion? What's the philosophy
behind
that?
Well, the reason for that is there would be less and less gun runners if, once again, they had consequences for their action. Because the average gun runner is putting that gun in the hand of a child anyway, or a person that's mentally disturbed anyway. And so there's no way to deal with him, but if you bring him into a circle that he has to stay in, and now you know that's his gun, and then he goes to jail for that gun right with that killer, a lot of them are gonna disappear. But the fact that you have no consequences, he's very comfortable selling a 9mm to a 9-year-old child. And I'm sure he'll tell you, now you're recruiting at 10 years old in the gang anyway. When I started trying to deal with gangs, I was dealing with 15, 16, 17. Now you gotta go down to 10 years old and someone telling a 10-year-old child, if you shoot him, you won't go to jail like me. You're a child, you go home to your mother. Well, you're gonna fire that gun. And then people are shocked, like in Anwant the other day, that a child shows up with a gun. The guns are readily available in your community.
In what school down the street?
Yes, right down the street. Or remember it was in Henry a couple weeks ago. It's because they're readily available. We don't respect the children enough to not sell them a gun.
You said you were in Henry and you discovered in a matter of a few minutes that there were
11 different gangs. 11. From the first time I got there, I discovered 11 different.
How did you do that? How did you discover that?
Walking and talking to those children and who's what. Mm-hmm. When I was in there a few years back, I discovered 18 gangs on the property. And I'm sure if I'd had more time that day, the number is probably gonna be greater. Because remember when they asked me in an interview, what do you see as the biggest problem facing Black America? I don't know if you remember this. I said gangs. And the chief and everyone else said, I don't know what I'm talking about. There are no gangs in Minnesota. And so they got real crazy on that. But when I did the first gang summit in St. Paul, in a 4-day period, I registered 9,700 gang members that didn't exist in the Twin Cities. Then everybody had to shut up. Mm-hmm. But I'm saying, anytime you leave anything alone like cancer, it doesn't go away, it spreads. We left the gang situation alone, didn't feed it what it needed, and it spread it. Now what is that? Unemployment. You gotta give them employment. Education, they have to be educated. But when you live in a community like ours, Black youngsters, you get dressed, take your bath, go outside, stand in front of your house, you look to the left, you look to the right, and there's absolutely nowhere to go because there's nothing in the community for you to do. There is no bowling alley. There is no movie show. There's no video place. There's no roller rink. You look and you see there's nothing to do but hang in the streets.
That's a bad combination and a bad mix to put together. Children with nothing to do with adults who will take advantage of them with drugs readily available. That's a bad mix.
And we got to fix that. Al Flowers, thank you for being here. Al Flowers is I called him the field marshal of community organizing in Twin Cities. Al, thank you for being here. Jump in this conversation. You've been talking a lot about the need to change the narrative, that what we're describing here, this history and this story about gang violence, the history of lack of accountability and improper policing of our community, the history of the disparities we experience in education, in health, in wealth, in income, in opportunity, all of that sort of is a big story that is self-sustaining. And somehow, I've heard you say, we got to break through. What do you think?
Right now, we're vulnerable as a people, as African-American people, young people, as black people. We are vulnerable because we're not listening, and they don't know how to listen. Our young people don't know how to listen, and so that's why we're in a dangerous situation in this community and our community all over because of not listening. That we you can influence our young people by saying, okay, come on, let's go out here and fight, and then when they say let's go fight, but they don't know what they're going to fight for, and that's the problem that we're having right now. And that's why I keep pushing back. When you get people to attack our clergy, our leadership, and say things about our leadership, and saying it's my time to lead. Well, if it's your time, get out here and lead. We're looking for people all the time to come on and join us. Join in the movement. They don't know what to do, so they. It's a bad time for us right now. And when Spike was sitting here talking, we don't have to say nothing. I can sit here and listen to him because I know he's already been through it. He's telling us so we don't make the mistake again. But this generation that said, okay, we want to step up, but you don't want to listen to nobody. And then when you run into that wall, you don't know what to do, and they scared, and I will be frightened until they understand. No, you got to listen. And nobody's trying to tell you what to do. It's a thing about saying that we shouldn't get resources, we shouldn't get money, you know, and that's not true. Even the ones that saying they want to come up and get up, you want resources. You're not going to be able to stand out here and do this. This is a hard job if you don't have resources to do it. And they give billions of dollars in this government to make sure we are right, but they give it to the wrong people.
We started off, Al Flowers, talking about just a quick snapshot of where we are with the 4th Precinct protest and the community's response to the police shooting of Jamar Clark. This morning, 4 a.m, they dismantled the occupation at the 4th Precinct. And Spike gave a sort of an analysis of where we are in terms of that being a protest movement. How do you see it? How would you describe if you were gonna talk to somebody who'd been out of town for a month and they come in town and they say, Al, what's going on? What's the story you tell them in 3 minutes, a 3 minute story?
I would tell them that we got everything we wanted as a community. I would say, we were for the protest, the people out there protesting, but our organization, our institutions like the Urban League and our clergy stepped up to the plate. They did it the right way so no one would get hurt. That goes to my earlier conversation, trying to don't mislead the young people because they're not educated on our history. They don't they think it doesn't matter, but it do matter. It still matters what our ancestors went through, and they try to downplay it. So I know how the police treat us, but we have to know when we did something good. We got a civil rights Department of Justice, Congressman Ellison, and the pastors and Steve Bell of the Urban League, along with the protesters, all wanted the same thing. We got it. And then once we got it, you gotta say, okay, what are we gonna do now? What are we gonna regroup? And our young people don't know the economics. That's the most important thing for us right now, education and economic, because if we get those two, then that would stem some of that despair, that disparity. They sitting out there, they have nothing to do. Spike said they looking left, looking right, and then they looking forward, then they looking for something to get into, and it's killing us. So I believe the protest was good. It was time for it to end. Mm-hmm. It was time for it to end because our seniors couldn't get out the high ride. Our youth, that you talk about all the pollution going up these babies' smoke. Nose. Yeah, all this smoke going all this up the kids' nose over there. And then the people didn't want it. They said, okay, Dan, we got what we wanted. Now let they held the, they really was holding the people over north hostage for no reason. Take it downtown. When they went to City Hall, they locked City Hall up. They locked all the doors and wouldn't let them in. They wouldn't let them in. Now, yeah, I would have said, if you wanted to protest, stay down there all day and let our people drive up and down Plymouth, because I even myself was getting tired. I'm trying to go to the Urban League, or I'm trying to go back to Lindale, and I got to go around, and we had got everything we needed out of them.
When we come back, I'm going to talk about you, your vision of what an effective community should look like. I don't want to stay focused on the negative. I think we operate out of a positive vibration, mm-hmm. out of expectation, out of belief and faith. And we live because we believe that freedom can be mm-hmm. attained, that's why we work. I want to talk about the vision of what freedom looks like for us, Spike Boss, Al Flowers, and Brother Thomas. We'll be back in a minute. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations mm-hmm. with Al McFarlane. McFarlane, welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Al Flowers, Community Solutions today, right?
Yeah.
Also, Brother Thomas L. Barker, Jr., his organization is Community First Minnesota, the project What About You? Lifestyle Modification Management, and the elder, the leader, Spike Moss. Brothers, thank you all for being here. I wanted to go to you first, Thomas. Talk more about then what you are bringing as a solution. What do you want to tell? You're teaching boxing as one of the tools for lifestyle change and management. Talk about that.
Well, it comes from my What About You program. Comes from, I haven't been shot before, so, and then I had to look at my kids, you know, they might have lost their father, and the things that I went through, so I decided to change around.
Why were you shot? How were you shot?
What was well, it was actually an accident because I was just in a bad neighborhood. Okay. You know, I had groceries, and they thought I was someone else, and they shot me from behind. Okay. So I live with pain every day, so that's one thing.
How many times were you shot?
8 times.
Wow, okay.
So my What About You program has like 4 components. I deal with youth mentoring, I deal with boxing, I deal with youth enrichment, you know, tutoring, college prep, and then I deal with youth leadership development, you know, how to get out here and do what we're doing. Try to match them with elders as Spike Moss, Al Flowers, with community leaders, so that they can learn that, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? So it's basically about, you know, showing them, you know, life ain't just a game, you know, it's not a game out here. You know, and sometimes your decision can be final. And then a lot of it is just negative influence that's around them, so I'm trying to give them that positive
now,
influence.
How do you finance that work? Here's where I'm coming from. Too often, when we have great solutions and great energy, and we ought to have the ability to go to the public treasury mm-hmm. and say, I've got a solution. I'm in the middle of a problem pool, right? And I'm one of the people that has a solution, but the solution also needs resources, Al Flowers' word. How do you find resources to support your organization? That's question number one. And then Al and Spike, what's been the history of resources coming to our community, and I'll say it the way it really is, of denying our community the resources we need to be effectively managing our development, our growth, and our prosperity as a community. What about resources for you, Thomas?
Well, you know, I've been self-funded.
Okay.
So everything I've been doing, I've been working with 10 to 15 kids. You know, these are good kids that are turning their life around. There's good grades. You know, I teach them through boxing and a whole lot of different things. But it's been hard to find funding, especially as a new organization. There's not out there. You know, with the experience. I've been there, I've done that. And I'm just trying to show them the right way.
Al Flores, same story, right? What's you have the same experience?
Well, he said it all about how do we get there? Our legacy institutions, what I've been talking about in every media opportunity I can, when I talk about our legacy institution, that we got to make sure that they have the resources, so you don't have to go. The first stop got to be to our legacy institution, but our legacy institution must be empowered. They know what they're doing when they don't empower our institution. They know what they're doing when they split us up and try to make us fight against or say that, calling each other names, saying who's getting resources. That he says that I'm self-funded. You can't run no program self-funded. You can just, I mean, it'll kill you. So, but nobody else is running a program self-funded. They're getting the resources. We can't be afraid to say, no, we need the money. So when we talk about the resources and the economics, and we must fight for it and fight for it now, that I'm talking about right now. We're in the fight right now. When you talk about the narrative, we got to change the narrative. We got to fight back. We know, I don't care what you say about what somebody did. If you want to hold us accountable today, tomorrow, the next day, then you can do that. But you're not going to stop our community from getting the resources that this brother needs to help with these 10 or 15 kids, but it's got to come from our institution. Our institution is the one that got the power, and we have to bag the clergy, the community leaders, myself, Spike, we have to bag them up, the Stair Step, the Urban League, the Sabathanese. We have to push them up, the Hallie Q. Brown. We have to get behind them and then ask everybody to join us. This ain't no white against black. We need you, but we need to lead our own movement. We don't need nobody to lead this movement.
So we need to fully fund, legacy institutions and create the capacity in these institutions to bring resources to excellent initiatives like that of Brother Thomas Barker. This should be the place where all of our entrepreneurial, social entrepreneurial activities can go to get technical support, to get funding, to get resources and space to do the work.
And that's why Al, you are important. You and our black media, KMOJ, that's why y'all are important, because that's the message, and we need to be tweeting it out. That's what's going on now. I'm saying we have to, people, myself, Thomas, and we have to tell our young people what's really going on, because if we don't, they're going to get misled the wrong way.
I'm going to take you back a little bit now. We hadn't talked about this, but this conversation brings us to mind. I'm going to throw some names out, and I want you to use this set of names to review the power relationship and the money relationship between the black community and white power community. The names and organizations include, first of all, the Urban Coalition. Mm-hmm. How was that created? Names like Russ Ewald. Mm-hmm. Russ Ewald was the organizer of the Minneapolis Foundation, I believe, before it came into being. Mm-hmm. He was a private kind of go-to guy for corporate people. Prior to Russ Ewald's emergence as a central clearinghouse for getting money to black communities, there were direct relationships between organizations like The Way, between people like Syl Davis and Gwen Jones Davis, mm-hmm. and the CEOs of various corporations in Twin Cities. So there had been a history of the so-called titans of industry being directly involved in the community. Mm-hmm. More when communities started to both emerge and erupt, challenging structural injustice, right? Prior to that, from my point of view, the relationship between black folks and money was that some of our people worked as drivers, worked as housekeepers, right? Mm-hmm. Worked as in servant type jobs, both in homes and in companies, but there had not been an opportunity for real broad employment, economic development in our community. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So I'm just trying to describe a general picture here. So I'm thinking that somehow when, say, the 60s, this fervor for development began to emerge in our community and a demand for change, the demand was made and laid directly on the table of the corporate leadership. Mm-hmm. They responded by bringing resources and talking about how we can change the employment picture and other things. What's happened since that time?
Well, first of all...
Is that correct, first of all?
Yes, but you have to remember that there was a rebellion on the street in North Minneapolis in 1966. The fear of black people rebelling in the street brought all those heads together to bring money in the community, but that was blood money. It wasn't about being good and doing right. It was to make sure that the rebellion that they called a riot, because remember, they started calling all the rebellions in America riots, because a riot is something spontaneous without a direction or a purpose. Black people were rebelling to the oppression. And so they were trying to slow that down, throw some crumbs out there the way the king used to give somebody a piece of cornbread, and maybe they'll slow down for a minute. But shortly following that, they created people like Rush Limbaugh, who spent almost 20, 30 years of just spreading poison across America and racism across America. Almost every talk show host like that was spreading the venom that brought about all the militias, that brought about the higher numbers in the Klan, the Nazi Party, the skinheads, the Aryan race, and they began to grow stronger in their hatred. The militias began to go into the woods and train themselves for the urban war that don't exist, that people in the urban city weren't thinking about, and protecting ourselves from those blacks and buying our guns and teaching our wives and children how to protect ourselves, and everything dried up and went away. And they're still buying guns, waiting for the urban war that they're going to start. We're not thinking about urban war. They are. Mm-hmm. I was at Kennedy King College in Chicago dealing with black reparations, and across the hall, all of the chiefs of police in the United States of America were meeting at the same time. So when I came out the room, I said, "What are y'all meeting about?" And they said, "Urban warfare." I said, "How are you having an urban warfare meeting and there's no urban war? That means they're going to start it." So what you have to do, I have to make the people suffer enough to fight back or start something, and then we can bring out the new tanks and the new armored cars and the new guns and the new bombs and weapons and get rid of the problem.
And guess what?
Mm-hmm. That's what they did. The other thing that's important that Al didn't bring up is years and years ago, I brought up something called fair share. And I had a campaign called the Fair Share Campaign. Black people didn't understand the importance of in every state getting your fair share. It's not about begging. It's not about making people do. It's about getting your fair share of what you put in. If you put in over $4 billion worth of money every year, over $4 billion, and you don't even get back $10 million, there's something wrong. And so everything that you have is suffering. It was almost 8 years ago that they announced that the banks in Minnesota are redlining against African Americans. They made that clear. It was just towards the end of 2014 that they announced that the banks that treat black people the worst in the United States of America are in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And out of those banks, the one that treats us the worst is Wells Fargo. Well, if your banks redline against you, you can't borrow money to put together businesses to hire your own people and own something. So you got social service choosing white programs to come in and give you service and get that money from you, and then you got the economic money being denied you from the banks. So how do you come up out of poverty? You also need an education to get a better job, but how do you get a better education when the person oppressing you is teaching your children and teaching them about everything but them? So your motivation, your excitement, your self-esteem is not raised. The value of education, if you got 10 of us in a room, maybe 6 to 7 have no value, you're gonna be destroyed in the education system in Minneapolis, Minnesota, between 7 and 8. The number of our children being destroyed between 7 and 8 is far too great. Any excuse you use to suspend them, any excuse you use to expel them, they're losing their education. When they come out of school, if they make it to high school, they're not even qualified to pass a college exam to enter college if you live in Minneapolis, Minnesota.
60% failure rate.
Any other city where you say the graduation rate is 60% failure, there'd be an outcry that you could hear from
from here to Chicago. Mm-hmm. We are 60%. Mm-hmm. So that means that the bulk of us are not graduating, which means you can't get to college, which is higher learning. When you get to higher learning, you can't get that higher income. If you can't get the higher income, you can't build businesses. If you could build the business, the bank's not going to give you the money. So they got you in a box of controlling poverty. Then you got to look at minimum wage. Who makes the decision on minimum wage? The white politician. Who's the majority that keeps it down? The white Republicans. When you keep minimum wage down and now you're talking about giving people $9.10 an hour, that's 20 years late. That won't fit today. A single man or woman, single, need $20 to $25 an hour to pay the bills that you pay today. So if you look for a single bedroom apartment, you're looking at $1,000 to $1,200. So if it's $1,000, what does the landlord say? I want $1,000 down first payment, $1,000 down last payment, and I want $1,000 down deposit. Well, if you're making $6, $7, $8 an hour, by the time you get your $3,000 to $3,600 put together, that apartment is gone. So if you're not making $20 to $25 an hour in 2015, 2016, you ain't doing nothing. What that means, Al, is I'm controlling your destiny, I'm controlling your poverty, I am now nurturing and shaping the control of your destiny and your life. So that speaks to why black families' average income is $27,000 and under, and white family average income is $62,000 and up. Because you're controlling our destiny, you are guaranteeing our poverty. Now, the outcome of that brings about the misery. The misery makes you lean to cigarettes, alcohol, and drugs. You see what I'm saying? Now you're in the street, a young person, your mama can't give you shoes, she can't buy you a shirt, but my brother here, he got a dope bag. I got to get my hand on a dope bag if I want some Jordans. I might not want to do wrong, but I have no other outcome. So now the Americas have more prisons than all the countries of the world put together, and we're 80% of who's in those prisons, and we're coming in there at 14 and 15 years old, and we're coming out at 27, 29 years old. America wins again. America is stepping to the plate, hitting home runs on all these issues, and then hiding their hands, acting like they had nothing to do with taking away your destiny. We have every right to demand our fair share of what we put in. Black people said in the 1950s, we should not accept taxation without representation. Taxation without representation. Now let me say this and I'll stop, that black America doesn't understand. We have to declare our sovereignty to get out from under this. You see, the United States of America is a corporation. We have to step out from that and step into America and become sovereign. If we become sovereign, we don't owe them no tax, we don't have to go through all this mess we're going through, and we can stand up finally. And if we would wake up and understand the importance of sovereignty and demand sovereignty, we can get out from under this oppressive hammer that they're beating us down with. We need to understand that. The second thing we need to understand is we need to declare ourselves as a nation. We might not know if we're from which country, which village, but we know we're from Africa. We know that from the West Hump to the East Coast is a Sudan nation. That is the oldest nation in the history of Africa. We're from that region, we can declare. We know the Moors are from that region, we can declare. Whoever we declare as a nation, we can now step forward to the United Nations of the world and declare against America its crimes against our humanity. You can't do it as a people, you have to do it as a nation.
Mike Moss, thank you so much. As I promised, robust conversation. Spike Moss, freedom fighter. Brother Thomas L. Barker, the organization is Community First Minnesota. The program, What About You? Lifestyle Modification Management, and Brother Al Flowers, Community Solutions Today. Gentlemen, thank you so much. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. Thank you.
Programming is supported by UCARE, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCARE, healthcare that starts with you.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out, wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say goodnight. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words, and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning, right around 9. 9 o'clock. Cause we're gonna play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Cause this thing is safe. The message is clear. Everybody knows we gotta keep it nice clear. We just going to talk about the McFarlane Show.